is the story of my as yet incomplete 1 to 64 scale scratch build model of HMS Bellerophon of the late 18th and early 19th century. She was a 74 gun third rate man of war of the British Royal Navy, launched in 1786. My build will represent how she looked when first introduced to service about 1790. At the end of her service, the battle honors awarded were the glorious 1st of June, Cornwallis's retreat, Battle of the Nile, and the Battle of Trafalgar. Her last honor was to be the ship upon which Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte surrendered. She was 168 feet long along the gun deck and had a 46-foot-9-inch beam. My build is 31.5 inches between perpendiculars and 8¾ inches across the beam. My journey began in December of 2013 as a complete novice requiring a massive amount of research. I had a lot to learn about ships and shipbuilding. First was acquiring lines, framing, and deck plans, and the build contract from the National Maritime Museum. I purchased plans for the sister ships Goliath and Elephant because the Bellerophon plans weren't available. And they were built and launched at about the same time, but from different yards. I found the contract for Bellerophon to be identical to that of the Elephant, and later realized that the contract was made from a template for these ships. Then came my uphill battle or journey to understand it all. I decided to transcribe the build contract with definitions and reference sources that explained the words used in plain present-day English, so I'd be able to retrieve and understand their meanings years later, because I assumed my build wasn't going to be done in a month. It went from 24 original sheets to an outstanding 80 pages complete with an index. I also gathered articles mentioning the ship from 86 newspapers seen listed here via the British Newspaper Archive and from documents acquired from numerous genealogical and other websites, a compilation of 464 warship articles and letters, plus another 62 from her period as a convict hulk, creating 158 transcribed pages of her 50-year history. This was the source of my ship history presentation last April. I created this 2D drawing to better appreciate room and space, station lines, and frame location. I used DraftSight, which was a free program at the time, but unfortunately now they charge a subscription fee. I then made a 3D model of the hull and sliced it to create my frame templates. I actually had to draw it three times, once due to a computer crash where I lost everything, and twice more due to changing jobs, which changed the type of 3D program available to me, first in SolidWorks and then in Autodesk Inventor. These competing programs are not compatible. They will not allow you to open the other program's files. Presently, being retired, I use the free hobbyist version of Fusion 360. I prefer to stand when I'm working and felt a variable height build table would be more suitable for me. So I designed and built one. It raises to 45.5 inches and lowers to 30 inches off the floor electronically via push buttons on either side of the table. There is a stationary tabletop portion to one side and a manual tilting build portion that locks in 5-degree increments up to 60 degrees port and starboard to assist my reaching over or inside the model. I began my build with Eastern Hemlock in 2016 because I had a seemingly endless free supply of it, but I soon learned soft, grainy fir is not a good wood for ship-scale model building. So I started over using Southern American Castello boxwood, I began with the five pieces of the keel. Here you see the stern post tenon, the stem post boxing scarf joint, and the individual scarf joint section. I made a scraper out of a scrap piece of aluminum and cut my rabbet lines in the assembled keel. I've since learned that old hacksaw blades annealed with a flame is a recommended source for scraper material. I used black monofilament fishing line to represent scaled nails and bolts. These were roughed up with sandpaper to allow the glue to grip and hold it to the wood. I use yellow carpenter's PVA glue almost exclusively on my build. False keel staples were made from copper wire over a hex nut anvil. The anvil was used to flatten the top of the wire staple. These were blackened using liver of sulfur, but as my first attempt, it was a disaster as most of the oxide layer eventually flaked off after the install. I chose to leave these as they were, as it looked aged from a distance, and I kind of liked it. My two-piece stern post was pinned with a tenon joint into the keel, and the five-piece stern deadwood was assembled. After having rubber glued a number of cutout templates to the wood blanks, I learned to trace them onto the blanks with carbon paper to save my templates and simplify cleanup. I use a cut-off piece of crepe block that I use to clean my sandpaper on my belt sander and whatnot. I use that as an eraser, this crepe block. I use it as an eraser to remove the rubber cement residue from my pieces. So here you see a little piece of paper. I'd have to peel that off, and it would be a mess sometimes. And then I'd have to get the rubber cement off. And if I made a mistake, that template was ruined. By tracing it on with carbon paper, I didn't have to worry about my template being ruined. I could use it over and over and over again if needed. The stem post assembly was fitted to the stern boxing scarf joint of the keel. The cutwater piece was the last part added, as seen in the bottom left, right in here, which would be this little thin piece right in here. It was steamed and clamped in place with elastic bands to help it set properly into this slight bend recess. It was sanded to proper thickness while in place or in situ. Bolts were added at the boxing scarf joint and copper horseshoe brackets fitted port and starboard at the stem, and L brackets fitted likewise at the stern. The 9-piece transom pieces were installed with 5 filler pieces below. Frames were made in their individual pieces, including chocks. Wood blanks were glued in pairs with rubber cement. So after tracing and cutting one frame, I had in fact produced 2 identical pieces, a port and starboard matching set. Cant frames required the heel or foot and the chocks to be beveled to their requisite angles, and finally bolts installed, taking care to assure that all bolt patterns match from frame to frame. The night head timbers were clamped in place to the stem post, and the bowsprit hole was sanded to fit the 36-inch diameter bowsprit mast with a piece of dowel wrapped in sandpaper to match the requisite diameter. So here you see the dowel and the sandpaper, and I slipped that in between and just rotated it until I had this shape sanded in place. And then those could be glued on. The hawse pieces were installed, followed by the forward cant frames. Hawse holes for the anchor cables have not been cut in as yet, even to this day. A lightweight foam core board support was made to help hold the cant frames in place in their appropriate angles as the PVA glue set and cured. So here's my foam core support, and the frame is held in place with elastics, and I have a square here to make sure it lines up with the template down on the table below. And it's stayed like that overnight. Till the next day, I could take everything apart, and the glue was cured. The aft cant frames were installed up to the first few square frames. A stiff board was used to support the square frames while the glue set and cured. You'll see this more clearly in another slide. A brace was glued to the timber top running athwartships to help stiffen and hold things together while fairing the hull. So here's my stiffener piece up on top. Here's my support board for the square frames, and you'll see that again in another picture. Fairing began at the bow with the hawse pieces beginning with rough shaping and finishing with sanding. It was at this time that I realized I needed to rethink how my model was being held down to the build table. As it was, I was soon not going to be able to reach the wood screws that held the keel clamping battens in place because they'd soon be covered over by the square frames. So here's my keel. In behind, you can see a screw here and here, and there's another one back in there, and there's a batten. And there's three holes here where there was a batten in front. So that clamped both sides of my keel in place, and it was held in there pretty tight. Once those square frames went on, I wouldn't be able to reach those screws to remove that one batten to be able to lift my ship off. So I had to come up with a new idea. Many models have hex nuts installed in the keel, as can be seen in the top right mock-up, as used a bolt or a screw from below to hold it in place. So here's my keel mock-up piece. I just took a block of wood and I traced out the false keel and the rising wood and whatnot. And here I have a hex nut, and you can see that it pretty well chews away everything there. This nut seems to require the removal of too much wood for me, even if the nut width were to be cut thinner. As frames will be glued to this surface, the top surface, it seems advantageous to me to have as much wood surface there as possible. I decided to use four number 832 stainless steel thread inserts, as shown in the top left and center images. So there's a thread insert on a threaded rod, and here's the thread insert in a hole. These are longer than a hex nut, and so provide more threads to hold down the model. First, I used DraftSight to sketch two support pedestals to visualize their most appropriate locations, as can be seen in the middle image. So here's my model, and I sketched in and moved this around a few times, some blocks, with the two screw locations, to try to figure out what looked the best. I intended to install two bolts in each pedestal. When I had this figured out, I drilled two pairs of stepped holes in the keel at these locations. The lower part of the hole was sized smaller for the outside diameter clamping threaded rod or bolt, and the upper portion sized larger for the outside diameter of the threaded insert. I applied petroleum jelly to my clamped down threaded rod and assembled the insert onto the threaded rod. I applied a two-part epoxy to the outside of the threaded insert and pulled it down into the hole by pulling down on the threaded rod till it bottomed out on the step. Then I tightened up the screw to clamp it in place until the epoxy cured. The petroleum jelly on the threaded rod kept the epoxy from passing through the threads of the insert and bonding the insert to the rod. That would have been a terrible predicament. On the top far right, you can see how much less wood has been removed as the thread insert assembly is behind the thread hex nut in my full keel test piece. So here's the hex nut, and there's the hole with my insert, and there's all this extra wood. I left the original far side batten of the original holding method in place to help locate the keel on top of the table. So that far batten is still in there, and if I take this off, I just slide it up to there, and I know it's going to line up with the holes. And then I marked with a pencil where those holes were on that batten, so it's easier to line everything up blindly and then reach underneath with my bolt and screw it in place. I then began installing the remaining square frames. Here you can see the support used to hold them in place as the PVA glue sets and cures. The top of the frame assembly is held with an elastic band. So it's clamped on this side and on the far side, and this board holds my square frame in place. The elastic band holds the top, and I use a square to make sure it lines up with my plan down below. Eventually, all the frames were installed. And in the bottom, you can see all the different pieces that make up my frames, the cross chalk and the floor and the chocks and the futrocks and the timber, the top timbers. The gun ports were roughly marked off by transposing elevations with a graduated square, so stiffening space chocks could be installed between the frames at locations both above and below the gun port hole, as seen in the lower image. This was to stiffen up the assembly before I started cutting out the gun ports and installing the sills. So here are all my little spacer chocks. Here's my pencil marks on my gun ports, and clamped it up with some elastic bands, glued them in place, let that dry, and moved along and did all the other ones. I was then back to fairing out board and inboard. I made the 5-piece scarf keelson and installed these above the floor timbers. The bolts have been installed now, but not at the time of this photo. So here they are just laying in place, dry fitted. I hadn't drilled and put the bolts in, and they're not glued down as yet. Here are the 5 pieces with all their scarves and whatnot, the joints. I then built a height gauge to assist in transposing the elevations of the plan to the hull more accurately prior to actually starting the cutout. The frame was constructed of hemlock lap strips using half lap joints in the corners and step lap joints at the base. A white plastic cap was added along the top to provide contrast and a sharp, clear edge to read the reference graduations on the pine pointer beam. The pointer is a long finishing nail. You can see it right there. After marking the gun port locations, I made paper templates for the 3 different gun port sizes, the gun deck, the upper deck, and the other decks, being the quarter deck and the roundhouse. I would fold these up and hold them to the hull to double check that my gun port cutouts were finished to their proper size. I did my rough gun port cutouts with a plunger or a plunging cutter in my Dremel. It has a drill bit tip and a knob style cutter along the shaft. It cuts with ease to the left, but it's possessed by evil demons and runs wild and uncontrolled to the right, so you really need to hold it steady and firmly. I finished the cutouts up to the lines with sandpaper wrapped around a flat file blade. Then I filed in the notches for the upper and lower sills. The angles of the notches are wider than the actual build, but this was what I was comfortable doing. Remember, I'm a novice. The upper being shaped with a small triangular file and the lower with a small square file. The sills were painstakingly fitted to the opening, glued in place, and sanded flush. And I spend all this time on that thinking, will all of these be covered later? A number of gun ports on the upper deck require plugs for the upper sill. As you can see in the plan here, there's 1, 2, 3, 4. The bottom of the upper sill was marked on the frame, notches sanded, and plugs fitted and glued. So here, I marked it, I sanded in the notches, I fitted my plug, and then I cut it and glued it in place. Here we see the gun ports completed and final sanding to be done. I had left my timber tops oversized because I was concerned I might damage them at a finished 3/32 of an inch thickness. So this needs to be cleaned up. All the timber tops here are thicker than they need to be. Before I begin the deck beams, I need to button up the stern. The first thing to make and install were the side counter timbers. On my third try, I made a support to free up my hands. Here's my support back here. I cut them wider than required and pinned the inboard side to help locate them. With these glued in place, I began fitting and installing the filling timbers from the aft cant frame back. I completed filling in above the side counter timbers and the three door openings on the both sides, which you can see the three door openings here, 2, 3, and over there on the other side. I then made my roundhouse and quarter deck transom beams. The roundhouse transom beam and the quarter deck transom beam is down here, along with another one that the quarter deck transom beam fits in right here. While dry fitting the transom timbers, I saw an error. My side, counter, and filling timbers were sanded rounded inwards above the knuckle. These should have been a straight line flaring outwards to the location of the timber top. So here, the timber top here is in the right place, but these start to go inboard, and they should have been going the other direction. So I had a big mistake there for when I started filling this in with some pieces of wood. So this was all good. And as I'm a novice, it doesn't need to be perfect, but I would like it to be nearer correct. So I tore it all out to do it again. The next time will be better now that I have some experience, but my scrap pile continues to grow. And this is where this part of my build is at present, but it's not quite all of it. All that framing was quite exciting when I started, but soon became repetitious and boring. So I worked on other parts during all of this to keep my spirits up. Here we see the assembly of the tabled rudder pieces. The square tiller holes were filed to a taper, smaller hole outboard to a larger hole inboard. The backing and sole pieces were added to the tabled rudder. A chatter groove was cut into the backing piece and the bolts were installed. So here you can see the chatter groove and the backing and the sole piece. You can just see it down there. Another view of the chatter groove on the left and the metal banding with bolt heads and pintles installed on the right. The banding is blackened cardstock and the bolt heads are drops of white weld bond glue applied with a toothpick. It dries clear, so the bolt heads seem black as the cardstock behind them is black. So all those little bolt heads are just clear glass-like drops of glue that you can see through, so it picks up the black color in the back. I also created 3D models of my carriages and guns. The carriages were printed on my 3D printer using a PLA wood mix filament. The barrels were 3D resin printed by a member of our local Niagara Club using my 3D models, and they show every detail, including the pan, powder hole, and royal cipher. The ship was equipped with 28 32 pounders, 28 18 pounders, 14 9 pound long barrel guns, and 4 9 pound short barrel guns, of which you see a sample of each here. And she was issued 12 1.5 pound swivel guns at 6 for the lower foremast top and 6 for the lower mainmast top. This image is of my 3D model imported into a cross-sectional 2D sketch of my top to assure that the installed gun wouldn't be aiming at the edge trim of the platform. They were 3D resin printed, as you will see shortly. So you can see I got it set at just the right angle that I'm not shooting myself right here. I discovered just lately she was also issued 6 18-pound carronades for the roundhouse and 2 32-pound carronades for the forecastle. These and the swivel guns were in excess to the count of 74 guns for the ship. I created a 3D model of the larger carronade, copied and scaled it down for the smaller, and they are being resin printed right now. As a matter of fact, today I received an email from a member of our club he told me that he just successfully printed them. I haven't got a picture of them, so I can't show them to you right now. I intend to make the carriages in wood, as there are so few of them. The top image depicts how the carronades were mounted between 1782 and 1790. Here are my staged bowsprit, jib boom, jack staff with the Union Jack, correct for the era, tied to the halyard, and the spritsail and spritsail topsail yards held temporarily with elastic bands. There is no martingale boom, also called dolphin striker, suspended from the bowsprit cap, as that wasn't introduced until 1794. The bowsprit was a made mast, meaning it was assembled in various coked cable pieces and held together with bolts, a couple metal hoops at the heel, and welding hoops along the remainder of the length. I made my bowsprit mast in one piece and added blackened cardstock metal hoops and steamed and bent wood planed shaving welding hoops. Welding ropes have not yet been installed. The flag is hand painted onto silkspan with acrylic paints. This is my lower made main mast, trees, fighting top, and cap. Mine is a made mast without the coked tabling, which is similar to pockets in fitted keys. Here in the top image, we see the spindle sandwiched between the side trees and cheeks before it got turned. Below, the full-looking front fish or rubbing paunch that extended all the way down to just below the orlop deck and very near the heel, which was correct for the time period. So all models seem to have this terminate above the deck, whereas at my time period, it extended through all the decks. And this is in fact a made mast. You can see the middle piece coming up through here and the cheeks and whatnot on the outside. You can see it here also. Here you can see the split. Here I was installing the bolts. She had both wooden and metal hoops. The metal hoops are blackened cardstock and the wooden welding hoops are steamed and bent planed wood shavings. Welding ropes have not been installed yet. This is about when my 3D resin printed swivel guns arrived by post. They were printed from my files by a local club member. Here they are fitted to the gun chock on the lower main mast top. So there are the swivel guns here and over there. Here I've painted my guns with multiple light spray coats of acrylic black paint. Here you can see the swivel guns fitted after painting. You can also see the safety railing at the aft end of the top and the two-piece cap with the faux leather coating at the step for the main top mast. So there's the coating, just a little fuzzy. It's not quite in focus. And my two-piece cap, there's the split line and the railing and stanchions. I completed the other two lower tops for the foremast and the mizzen mast. The lower foremast top has swivel gun chocks, whereas the lower mizzen mast top does not. These are presently stored safely, clamped to a wooden base, and their handrails backed up against a solid support guard so they do not get damaged. Here's my box with my clamping base and whatnot, and the handrails, all three of them are up against these secured backing boards so they don't get damaged. There are no images of the first figurehead for this ship that was damaged beyond repair in a collision at sea in 1793. Only written description of it exists. So I had to sketch my version from the description and then create a modeling clay marquette over a wire frame to be used as a carving reference. It took me three attempts to carve the figurehead in Castello boxwood, I made it in four pieces. The two bodies with the wings as one piece. The cape is another piece. The javelin shaft and then the javelin head are two more pieces. It was finished in acrylic paint. The white bodies and the white helmet plume, the red cloak, the gold helmet, and the black javelin. More colorful figureheads were not approved by the Admiralty until 1814. Planning ahead, I've created 2D layout drawings for my deck beams. Here are the upper deck and the gun deck layouts. In the lower right corner is a snip of the cat head and tail in isometric. I've also drawn the roundhouse and the quarter deck and the forecastle. I've not drawn the orlop deck, and I'm not sure I will bother because it's pretty deep in the hull and probably won't be seen. These are drawings that I've made for my lower, main, fore, and the mizzen mast. I'd like to have these built before I start installing the deck beams. I also made 16 templates for all my rope blocks, of which a few drawing samples are shown here. Lastly, this is my drawing of the ship's wheel fitted between the roundhouse and the quarterdeck, just forward of the mizzenmast. There's the wheel here. And here are my pieces all drawn out in detail. It was a double wheel with a tall forward pedestal and a short aft pedestal, exactly as can be seen in the photo from the Victory in the bottom left. So when I get bored, I can work on the mast, the blocks, assembling the 74 guns, or making the ship's wheel. Here is a summary view of what I've got done on my build. All framing except closing up the stern, which I'm working on presently, the rudder, made lower main mast and tree with swivel guns, bowsprit and jib boom, jack shaft and jack and union jack, figurehead, sprit sail topsail yards, lower foremast tree and swivel guns, lower mizzen tree, and all 74 guns in four sizes. This concludes my build presentation. Thank you.